Resolution P94, professional and personnel tenure. Be resolved upon the recommendation of Dr. Paul J. Catalino, Superintendent of Schools, that the following persons be appointed on tenure in the city school district in the area specified and on the date indicated, contingent upon the successful completion of his or her probationary period and maintenance of valid certification. I'm not going to read all the names to you because we'll be doing that in a minute with the certificates. So, I'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. And then resolution CS27, teaching assistant tenure. Be it resolved upon the recommendation of Dr. Paul J. Panalino, Superintendent of Schools, that the following teaching assistants be granted tenure in the Kingston City School District. All those in favor? Before we move on, I'd like to turn the floor over to Dr. Catalino for a special report.
Yesterday, I had the pleasure of being able to go to an awards breakfast and speaking to our students. All I could think about when I was looking at their achievements and seeing them about to go up and get their awards is that wouldn't have happened without the teachers here who are about to retire. And that won't happen in the future without the teachers here who are receiving tenure. So I thank our teachers who are retiring for their commitment to the Kingston City School District and for everything you've done for our kids. And I thank you, our teachers who are getting tenure, for you looking forward and taking that challenge and that commitment forward for our students. You have big shoes to fill. So before you leave tonight, when you see the people come up for retirement, get their email address, get their cell phone number, because you're gonna need to speak to them. They know what it takes to make sure that our students achieve and go on to be who they need to be, who we want them to be. So I thank our retirees, and I congratulate our teachers who are getting tenure. I'm going off script a little bit today because there's usually, we do our tenure teachers first and recognize our retirees second, but there's one particular retiree who I would like to honor before we get started. This retiree started in the Kingston City School District in September of 1966. Started as a food service worker, a food service helper, what they called then a matron, which doesn't exist anymore in civil service, a cleaner, a substitute monitor, and then finally finished off her career as a monitor. 53 years in the service of the students in the Kingston City School District. And I would like to call up to honor Lorraine Dart. We have a lot of wires up here. So as we call people up, just be careful when you come through, and we'll try to make sure no one gets injured. So we'll start with our teachers who are receiving tenure tonight. And I challenge all of you to last 53 years in the Kingston City School District. We'll start with Christina Bartley. William Birch. Stephanie Carpenter. Brandon Carroll. Jennifer Conroy. Monica D'Amico. Tina Dierna. Christine Dolan. Jennifer Dolan. Allison Dudek. Blair Fahey. Allison Fisher. Deborah Franklin Feingold. Jessica Gardner. Judith Hakeem. Megan Hanafy. Holly Hooper. Ryan Kiernan. Jessica Faith Kinney. Joanna Lacey. Megan Landerwet. Susan Lasher. Alexander Longendyke. Vanessa Lovisa. Marin Malgiri. Mary Jo Martin. Pamela McFarland. Fritzy McGowan. Jill McMahon. Heather Mertz. Kelsey Maraldi. Nicole Molinaro. Zachary Murray. Heather North. Stephanie Tropiak. Linda Corey. Bonnie Shanker. Karina Moon. Kimberly Scott. Jacqueline Stocker. Regina Cantillo Swanson. Kim Tanglin. Christopher Thomas. Amy Torelli. Jennifer Tora. Christopher Van Fleet. Kelly Van Lone Warner. Christina Vermilia. Julie Williams. Franklin Zito. It's always good to have a Z's, and I know when to stop between the tenure and the retirement. So now to honor our retirees, Lois Arnold. Rita Beyer. Susan Blass. Kevin Bockelman. Margaret Boyce. Innocencia Clark. Leslie Clark. Darlene Craig. Anne Marie DiBella. Paula DiGilio. Lisa DiMaria. Deborah Eaton. Linda Getman. Gwen Grothkopf. Karen Grothkopf. Lori Gruber. Valerie Hannum. Barbara Hansen. Dorothy Hill. Kathleen Johnson. Joseph Kennedy. Kimberly Cross. Marie Lane. Donald Matthews. Bianca McGilruth. Sandy Nelson. First smiling face I see every morning when I come into my office. Barbara O'Mara. Kathleen Owens. Gail Clemmings. Rebecca Porter. Denise Radcliffe. Mary Jane Reese. Gregory Rogers. Mary Schneid. Patricia Vandermark. Mary Beth Veef. Elaine Wolf.
I would congratulate everybody who received tenure today, and also all of those who are embarking on retirement. Sorry. Can you hear me? No? Too loud? Can you hear me now? Yes, okay. I would like to congratulate all of you. For those of you who are embarking on retirement, many of whom I've worked with, I wish you health and many, many years traveling, spending time with your families and your friends, having a wonderful, wonderful time. For those of you who are embarking on your work as a tenured teacher, you've already been hard at work to earn tenure. And my husband loved to say that he didn't originate it, but that teachers touch eternity. You never know where the influence of a teacher is going to end. So for all of you, I congratulate you, and you're going to touch many, many lives. We won't know where the influence ends. Make it a good one. Thank you very much. I'm going to kind of depart from the regular, those of you who've been to other tenure celebrations know that regular order of business, because I'd like to entertain a motion to adjourn to executive session for the board, but I would like the board to spend some time with those of you who will be enjoying cake and refreshments in the lobby. So we'll postpone the adjournment for about 15 minutes. So I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. I believe there are refreshments in the lobby.
Call the public session to order. We have two resolutions coming out of executive session. Resolution 2018-POA-78, be it resolved that employee number 1003 shall be suspended with pay during the pendency of Section 3020A education law proceedings against said employee. I'll entertain a motion.
So moved. Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Anybody opposed? Abstentions. And the second, Resolution 2018-79, be resolved that the superintendent is hereby authorized to direct a comprehensive medical examination and evaluation, including psychiatric and or psychological examination and evaluation if necessary, of employee number 1690, in accordance with the provisions of Section 913 of the Education Law. And be it further resolved that the board hereby directs that employee number 1690 submit their medical records, if any, to the extent and for the time as determined by the examining physician or physicians to the board designated examining physician or physicians at or before such examination and or evaluation. I'll entertain motion. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions. Okay, thank you very much. And with that, we'll move on to the first opportunity for... We have a departure from the agenda a little bit. We're having a public hearing on the Jefferson Code, changes to the Jefferson Code, and to present that is Ms. Deirdre Brantley. Sorry, not used to the mic.
Tonight I'm here to present the code of conduct changes for the AHS Jefferson Student Code of Conduct. So basically, the changes that we were looking at this year were trying to address the issues of mostly the vaping in the school. So you'll see that some of the changes start appearing in the level two. lighters and matches and such. So we've changed some of the language in level two to address something that has came from the policy committee. So that's included in level two. And then level three is where we've included, we sort of moved from level two to level three, the use and possession of tobacco, nicotine, and other paraphernalia that we include for vaping type devices. And then again, the use of lighters and matches. So the committee felt very strongly that we separate the possession of it, having it on them, lighters and matches, and the use of it. And then if you go to level four, we added the distribution, sale, and manufacture piece of the tobacco, nicotine, or vaping type products. And then we also added some more restorative justice components to the range of outcomes, since, you know, we're working more on having the procedures in place here at PHS, giving administrators some more leeway in terms of how we approach restorative justice. And we included language at all four levels.
The commitment to Montessori is clear. On our website, our logo is GW Montessori. On the About Us page, our school vision is Montessori. We are organized into Montessori multi-age classrooms, unlike any other elementary school in Kingston. The job posting is focused on finding a Montessori administrator. Bilingual is positioned in the posting as a bonus. Nothing has changed. We are a Montessori school, not a Latino school only. I quote the Freeman. We talk about Montessori, but we're also 60% Latino in that building, Dr. Pettifino said. We should be more concerned with bilingual than we are with Montessori. So I think our focus is a little skewed on how we're approaching what people want in that building. On February 5th, when the superintendent came to meet with the parents, we stressed that our primary focus is for Montessori. We also identified that our strong Latino population, 40.9% instead of 60%, Dr. Pellegrino, a proficiency in speaking Spanish would also be a benefit, but that the primary goal is a Montessori and public school certified administrator. Montessori certification would take a minimum of 1.5 intensive years of study, not 8 to 12 weeks, Dr. Pellegrino. If you will pay for Montessori certification, I'm assuming you would also pay for a Spanish course. In fact, perhaps you should also offer a Spanish course to the principal at Chambers and Edson, 32.4% and 31.4% Latino respectively. For 10 years, our principal focusing on Montessori principles has made a deep connection to our whole community without Spanish fluency. Speaking of Ms. Hannum, one more correction, Dr. Catalino. Ms. Hannum was absolutely Montessori certified before she came to GW as a principal. In fact, Ms. Hannum was a Montessori student from 3 years old through 12th grade, trained as a Montessori teacher over 32 years ago, worked for two training centers as a Montessori teacher trainer, taught as a lead teacher in a Montessori school, and was a Montessori private school administrator for almost 10 years before receiving her public school administration certification and coming to Kingston. That is a similar level of commitment to this methodology that we are seeking. Thank you.
Our next speaker, Ilana Berger.
Okay.
three no takers, and a 1, 2, 3 minutes for May 8th, 2019. I'll entertain a motion. If there are any amendments or corrections to minutes of May 18th.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. First up on the superintendent's report, we have our presentation from our building principal, his final building principal presentation at Houston High School, Mr. Kirk Reinhardt.
Good evening. First, we'd like to say that the Connect program is fundamentally what we do with our students, which is connecting. The nice thing is that we've been able to attach the data. So in the effort of speeding it up, I'm going to read the first slide for you. The Connect program is a PBIS Tier 2 intervention based on a check-in, check-out system in which selected students are assigned a designated staff member who is responsible for monitoring their progress bi-weekly and reporting data to the Connect coordinators. The data is then shared with each connector, which is really a mentor, and the support team. The initial group of students was chosen from the KHS Summer 9 program of at-risk students entering their freshman year. Two students are currently assigned to each staff connector and are expected to check in with them. The goal of this intervention is to build relationships between students and staff, teach and reinforce positive behaviors, and improve the attendance, attitudes, and academics of the students who struggle in these areas. Responsible, respectful, ready to learn, and attendance. So the next slide shows an example of the surveys that were sent out to each Connect student's teachers on a bi-weekly basis. It started weekly, and then upon talking to our teachers, it was decided that bi-weekly would be more user-friendly and more beneficial, so we decided to do that. Again, around responsible, respectful, ready to learn, and attendance. And then an area for comments to be added by each individual teacher, and almost every single response throughout the entire year included at least a short comment.
So those are the conversations that we're seeing. So what we have are a couple of changes for the program for next year.
So this year we targeted mostly freshmen who coincidentally were classified as students with a disability. The way that Kingston High School students with an IEP are treated is they are already tracked very closely by a tracking teacher who's in constant contact with all of their teachers and monitoring them very closely, developing those relationships, and helping them to navigate through the school year. We would like to target next year incoming freshmen who are not already being tracked by a special education teacher to kind of expand the program to non-classified students. In order to service that, we are going to recruit more general education teachers to track those regular education students and also train them in how to track those students and to make those connections with them. We're also going to utilize the mentor program through our PBIS ambassadors and help them to transition our students out of the Connect program and help them to self-monitor without the involvement of a staff.
Thank you very much. Next, I have Tim Medina with our internship program. As you guys know, this is now a full-time position, and it's also a pathway for graduation.
Hi everyone, my name is Tina Girona. I'm the transition and internship coordinator. And this is Tiffany Scott. She's my MSW student and just graduated from Delphi University. So in 2015, only 14% of students with a disability were employed after graduation. And 62% of employers surveyed believe that public high schools were not doing enough to prepare students. I heard this and I was astonished by these numbers, and I thought about how I could change the statistics for Kingston High School. We wanted to raise awareness, and my goal was to fulfill the social, emotional needs while making students employable and work ready. Within 1 year, we were able to achieve great things with our students. At the Internship and Career Center, we are the connection between the educational system, the students, and our community. This is a little bit about why students should enroll in our Internship and Career Center. In this slide, we have some awesome pictures from some experiences that our students have done over the course of this year. So we had a great internship with Pratt Institute. We have some students that went down to the ICFF conference located at the Javits Center this year. We were able to honor four of our students there and their work that they did with the Pratt Institute, where they created and made art. This was a great experience. Three students had never been down to the city, so we got to take them on the High Line, and we did some really awesome things right within the city. The entire booth, if you can see up in that front or left, up top, that whole booth was dedicated to them within a system of about 3,000 booths. We have one of our students who's placing a book about agriculture and farming within and farming while being black. And so she decided to place her book, or a book that was donated to the school within our library. Some of our internship partnerships within our community are Cornell Cooperative Extension. They're hoping to come here next year and provide an after-school program if they get a grant to provide some work-based learning. Pratt came in this year. YMCA Farm Project has been an ongoing project that we have connected with. LBGTQ is a new one this year. The ARC employs our students and gets them ready for work within our community. We have the Read and Write program, the JFK After School Mentoring Program with Today's Students, Tomorrow's Teachers, as well as the Everett Hodge Center, the African Youth Library, and so many more. These are some more pictures of some of our students out on the farm. We also had some students that were building boats, and we also ran workshops at least twice a month during WOW. We teamed up with Deb Zale, and we were able to create workshops for our students, whether it be resume writing, how to nail an interview and get a job, from their skills of shaking hands, looking people directly in the eyes, and just being really confident. And then in the bottom, we created some awesome art for right around Mother's Day, where all the students were able to take home some of their things and give them out as gifts. So our statistics this year, as Mr. Reinhart had said, we are now a pathway to graduation. So students can use this as a 4+1 pathway towards the CDOS. And what that means is they have their four grievances and they are getting a CDOS with the work-based learning hours that they're doing through our center to graduate, either with a local or a Regents diploma. This year we had about 11 students who are using the CDOS to graduate. We have about 150 students who come in our doors on a revolving basis, whether it be to work on a resume, a cover letter, or just find employment. We have a lot of businesses within our community that are coming in and asking to post part-time positions or how they can hire our students. So we are really shifting the mold of work-based learning within New York State and really getting our students employable. And at the end of the internship, we hope that they develop the skills necessary to find employment and look for meaningful employment within their career choice. One of our success stories this year is a young lady who interned at the Burley Vet Clinic, and within a few months of interning there, she was offered a part-time position. And she came in and she said, am I still allowed to use these hours of work-based learning?
as you can see, a couple years ago, that was about 10 or 15 people. We have now over 100 enrolled. Next, Ms. Parker is going to talk about our PBIS program.
Any right behavior that we're going to see, because some kids that run, really helpful in the time of being on that. And then let's talk about the student exam. I think that was our big
Yeah, it was, so we took from the student agents, and everybody that got a student agent on top of everyone that got done and got an award basically meant thank you, you know, thank you for being a positive role model in the school community. I think that was just an important way to connect everybody in the school community.
So we made invitations for over 120 students.
Yeah.
Is that very selfish? To deliver those, they call the students down and invite them to our award ceremony. A lot of staff made trees and brought cookies and juice. We had the bathroom in the cafeteria, and some parents showed up even. The principal signed our 120 certificate, and the ambassador stood up and named all the students, all the staff, and they were not very helpful. But I think that was really cool, because once in February, once just a few weeks ago. And I think that was like the real heavy lifting. Started a leadership class this year and has a 25 and a half credit independent study. So we were working on leadership skills. Mr. Christian, who's a social studies teacher, helped write the curriculum for me so that I didn't have a leadership social studies component to it. And then we broke up into two options, restorative justice training or mentoring. So I was the restorative justice. We had a couple of people from Jenny Woodstock, but they also are on the Capstone Project and working with the Social Justice Center. They came down and trained these students over a couple of days. They trained them and students in action in the Social Justice Center. And we were actively trying to make our way into being useful in the building to get plans for next year. We've been working with the Restorative Justice Center. Matter of fact, we did a field trip on Monday to go out there, work with them, get a tour, and see how we can work together next year. And then that's our next year's plan. So we liked everything we did this year. It's always open to new ideas. It's a student, trying to be student-led, so the students feel it's something they need to really try. We like our leadership course to run during the school day. That way we have the opportunity to have the time to use for the circle or the report during the day so we can get it in and get it out and make it a month period this Monday and then next Monday, but that's very fun. We'd like to run so that we'll continue this run that we did up on the leadership 2 class, which includes an individual leadership project, so each student has their own building beautification or community project that they would proceed for.
Thank you, Ms. Barlow. And now, Ms. Barlow, we're going to talk about our mentoring program.
Level went up. So if they were red or yellow, they moved up to yellow and green, which means they're making progress with them.
50% of students. About 84% of those, if you can put it on the slide, are on track to graduate. So that was very major. A lot of them are some sped students, but sped students, as you guys were told, already have a tracking teacher. So I try to focus on the sped ed students who don't have tracking teachers. The cohort is amazing. The guidance counselors and social workers, they're also keeping track, so we're all kind of talking. And, you know, the students who are going to this class, we're also helping to find ways to make sure that they're here, they're attending, and they're going to be able to get the credits to graduate or keep their mentors. So next year, we're hoping to continue that, hopefully get more mentors, hopefully have less active students, but we want to continue this for next year.
Education is to increase our course offerings. So we had two teachers last year that wrote an African American literature class, and then we kind of published on how one this year.
Majority of the students and look at some kind of documentaries about celebrities who have gone back to them in their DNA, and they've seen like where they come from, and they've kind of done that journey. So I actually donated ancestry kits to them, and a lot of them, you know, filled them out with information and turned them in. And they, you know, they filled out, I just had them put an anonymous info, and they come with, you know, what do you think? And a lot of them were surprised by their ancestry, and they were like, why? So they were really into that. And you know, a lot of our kids, you know, can show economically that we don't have $100 to do an ancestry test, you know, but they really wanted to do it. So they were donated to them, and a lot of them had really great feedback, and they really loved that.
Thank you very much. We have one last group. Ms. Saletti and Ms. Taylor, we did a book study this year, so you want to talk about race?
So we decided to continue with the work that the district has been doing on culturally responsive education, disproportionality, all those kinds of things. We piloted a book study on a book called So You Want to Talk About Race, and I believe you guys all have read it as well. So we did a two-tiered book study where we gave copies of the book to the entire faculty, and then we also had a smaller book study for people who chose to be in that. That was about a group of 30. The entire faculty group, we met with them about four times during faculty meetings. The smaller book study, we met about once a month with them. And we just recently put out a survey and had them fill this in, so if you guys want to turn around, I'm sorry, it's behind you. There's all your surveys are back there. Oh, yeah, that's right. So they have the whole group study and the smaller book study. So what we were able to do is in the survey pull out, you know, people part of the larger book study, the smaller book study. We had about a 77% response rate from this, which I'm told is a good response rate. And for the faculty, I want to say for the entire faculty, when we did the larger group with them, we did an introductory faculty meeting with them. We went over general concepts with them at one point, giving definitions, what is racism, why is reverse racism not a thing, you know, different things like that, what is privilege, institutional racism, that kind of stuff. Around February, we did student voices with them, where Cassandra and Christina asked their students from the Alabama Lit class if they would be willing to answer some questions, and anonymously, excuse me, have them share with the faculty, which proved to be very, very meaningful to the faculty. We also had a few students read stories that they did from Black Student Stories Matter, from the TMI project, and after that we had another faculty meeting where we had faculty voices. So faculty members who took part in the smaller book study or have been doing the CRE things gave their feedback to the larger faculty as a whole. And it's been feedback that they've given to us that said that was very meaningful for our faculty, right? So you can see the questions we've got. Most of the faculty have read all or most of the book. They have been talking with their colleagues. They find that it helps them to talk more with their colleagues about issues of race and racism. Even better, helping them to talk more with their students about issues of race and racism. You can see those who are in the smaller book studies even more so. We asked them how they felt, how comfortable they were discussing race before the book study started and after the book study ended. You can see that we have people who are more comfortable doing it. And of course, smaller book study, as we're able to do that in a concentrated way, people were even more comfortable discussing this. And then this one has a book study, Change How You Approach Issues of Race and Racism in Your Professional Life. This is what we want, obviously. The numbers are not as high as we would like them to be, but this is a huge topic, ongoing. I think we've made some really good inroads, but we need to definitely do more of this. We asked about book studies in general, and you can see the faculty seem to believe that book studies are a very good way of discussing, you know, getting into topics like this. With each of these two questions, we allow faculty in the area to leave a comment, and so I'm going to put some comments up here for you guys. This is just a smattering of the comments, obviously. I think we got about 150 comments. These are just positive ones. There were a few negative ones, but the positive ones were overwhelmingly more in number than the negative ones. The district does have access to all of this, and so I see you guys want to be here. Our next steps next year, we are going to be doing a smaller group study, probably down to about 10 to 15 people, so we can really dig deep with two books. One is called White Fragility, one is called Why Are All the Black Kids Sitting Together in the Cafeteria? And the point is going to be and we also have to mention Amy Kagas, Sandra Gentleman, Amy Kagas, Kagas, who are doing this. The faculty members who take part in the smaller book study are going to then turn key pieces out to the faculty in department meetings, in faculty meetings, as many different ways as we can, because more of these comments that we've gotten, people do want opportunities and avenues to have these conversations. And ultimately, you know, our students need this stuff, they want this stuff. The feedback that the students gave about how they feel about the faculty acceptability being able to address issues and race shows, we have a lot more work to do.
And there's staff that really want more, time to come together and find ways to address these topics within their curriculum. And that's one thing that we also have to do, to talk to each other about how we can do that. I mean, in math class, because we look at that, how do I do that? All of the social issues that we are giving. So it's a wonderful opportunity. And I think next year, taking it to that next level and push it out and into the department meetings and get even deeper is going to really help up with the movement of the
student. And we're also looking into having the student staff, so you want to talk about their school study more. And it's just the beginning. We're very excited.
Thank you very much. Any questions for me? No?
Can you stay in
there?
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Reinhardt. Next is the superintendent's report. We have Mr. Tom Clapper with our buildings and grounds and construction report.
Entry for the Pine Street section. The entire
just took a picture of paint walls and doors because that's what I'm presenting to the rest of the building. Yeah, that's what we're doing. So, but it is 99% complete. We are going to have a walkthrough, Michael, walkthrough Friday for our certificate of occupancy. We're ready for that. There's a few little touches that we have to do here and there, but we're ready for it. This is the bathroom off the boardroom. I don't know if any of you saw that in the walkthroughs that you put. That bathroom has been closed for probably about 20 years. And my guys went in and they said, I couldn't get this thing working. They put new fixtures in, they think of the floors, the walls, everything. I couldn't go all the way to the cafeteria, but it was all new flooring in the cafeteria, and we couldn't do way into the cafeteria. It actually has a pattern to it, there's an iron body pattern, and a border for the basketball court. That work will be complete probably by tomorrow afternoon. Today, Mr. Parkin's there, and we were talking about security. Sorry about this picture. I tried to do it without the money. You can turn it up with anger there, but really not. I had a great conversation. They Adam Redder was talking to him about the PA systems and how the public system works. And Mr. Parker was discussing executions for fire and all those types of things. But all those plans are coming together. This is Pedro Gonzalez, one of the new members of our maintenance staff. He takes care of all our locks and keys. So what happens is the contractor supplies all the doorknobs and those things, and our guys make sure that they fit into our keying system. Pedro's been really very interested in getting the product ready. He's doing a great job. In the last probably 2 to 3 weeks, I've dedicated at least 3 to 4 of my guys there every day to get all the work done. We're getting staff coming over from Crown Street. We're marking out their rooms. They're trying to figure out the furniture's going to fit. There's some excitement about where they're going and how this is all going to work. It's all good. I'm glad to see that they're over there making sure everything's going to work. And I really don't have anything else. The field at the high school is going very well. They've not been any bridges. They're expecting to deliver a couple of 3 weeks early. The logo is designed, we come up with the colors for it, it's being manufactured as we speak. We got all the games in that we put for Mr. Silverstein, and that was a real challenge this year. We posted pretty out there with all the games, and of course, I really have to congratulate the guys in the field. They worked very hard this year. And one guy in time, and they were able to get in the field, his name is Daniel. He's been with the district for 22 years. He's our plumber. We have 2 brand new plumbers. One has been here for about 8 months, and the other one was hired last Thursday. And Donald has taken him around and shown him all the things that he knows about the buildings, and the knowledge that he's taken with him is really important to our new staff. I appreciate his hard work and everything he's doing for the community. Today we took in the bids for the epoxy floor and for the tile mortar. We are looking at the bids, and there's obviously a good direction of going with all of that, and doing close to the documentation, which I think we will report on the next one.
Thank you, Mr. Clapper. That is the end of the superintendent's report for this evening.
Thank you very much. And that brings us to the consent agenda. Are there any resolutions any trustee would like to pull from the consent agenda? Then I will entertain a motion to accept the consent agenda. Discussion? All those in favor of accepting the consent agenda, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstention. Thank you. Mr. Lamb, I won't spring this on you, but would you read the donations for us, Section D?
The district gratefully accepts a donation from the E.C. Meyer PTA of $291.50, a donation from the Community Foundation of the Hudson Valley in the amount of $1,371.85 for Kingston High School, and a donation for Jay Watson Bailey from the Community Foundation of the Hudson Valley in the amount of $300.
Thank you. And that brings us to committee reports. Reporting out tonight, we have Audit and Finance, and I'll turn the floor over to Mr. Michael.
Okay, the Audit and Finance Committee met last Thursday on May 30th. And the committee accepted the claims service report and the treasurer's report for the month of April 2018. And we have the two resolutions, which is called DOE 75 and DOE 76. I'd like to make a motion to approve.
Any second? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstention.
We also have the internal auditors where they presented us with their findings on the 2018-2019 risk assessment report, with all the recommendations, and already in the process to approve the draft at our next meeting on June 19th. Another thing, the internal auditors, every year we look for an area of operation where we can see if we can make any improvements or if there are any discrepancies. So this year we decided to have a look at the athletic equity audit, and he came with his findings and the recommendations. We already the administration looked ahead to the correct and actual plan, which will be presented to the board at our next meeting for approval. And the other thing I would like to report, we had the Kingstonian developers came to the meeting to give us some update about their project. They were very swift, and I had emphasized to them that the board will not take any position yet until all the studies are done, and also we expect in the pilot program that we requested from the IDA, and we will bring it to the board. I'm not sure when, maybe by the end of the year. So for the board discussion, and then we'll be taking some action if necessary.
That will be all.
Thank you, Mr. Michael. Any questions? Then we'll move on to the Teaching and Learning Committee and Dr. Jacobowitz.
The Teaching and Learning Committee is next. The conversation is focused on the CSEP plans for the CSI schools. The CSEP plans are now aligned with 600 years on the ESSA, which is a lot of kids. So we have two excellent
kids. I have to go closer.
We had two excellent presentations from Jack and Miller about how they're responding to the state visits And for both of them, I'm willing to focus on strengthening instruction and ELA, also innovative teaching techniques, and a focus on different approaches to discipline, both after an incident and also in a prevention mode. So those were excellent presentations. It's hard to kind of relay what they were all about. But they were really dynamic and were very impressive ways that these two schools are addressing the needs that were raised in their through their plans and in that process. And then we looked at the quarter three data. This was a focus on local assessments because this was the start for this quarter. So at the elementary level, what we are seeing is that many children are scoring in the tier two. So pretty much right below the line where they need to be. This really needs to be a focus of attention. So kids who are in this tier two level really need to be very focused. There's some good news in the data on the pushing classes in the kindergarten at Chambers and JFK, which sees some positive results in those classes, which is very exciting. And there's some talk about how we continue to monitor that and then think about ways to expand that process to other, or that system to other schools. At the secondary level, we talked really about how teachers are using data systems and looking at testing and really going down at assessments and really drilling down to each individual question and each individual standard to understand where student weaknesses are. And are able to look at some pre and post data to show that there's some positive outcome from that at that level of scrutiny. So the ability to really understand where our students are, our weaknesses are according to different standards and then teach to those standards is really showing some positive outcomes. Our next meeting is in July. I don't have the exact date. But are there any questions?
Thank you very much, Dr. And that brings us to new business. Is there any new business any trustee would like to raise at this time? Skipped over old business. I do want to remind you before we move on for other old business that June 12th, all the trustees are invited to tour Mahar. And if you would be there at 3:30, we'll be stepping off around 3:45. And we'll see the building after they've been inspected for the CO. So promises to be very close to being completely finished, I'm sure, by then. All right, any other old business?
I think I have something that might be our old business.
Can you
hear me? Hello? I had a few parents with concern, and I know we are in the midst of navigating through this process about the transfer of the stadium. And I guess the day of the track meet was after the Stockade last match. And it's apparent that there's sales of alcohol going on there for year one. And somebody actually sent me a picture with the sign that says Dean Stadium is their alcohol and smoke-free facility. And the day after that match, the kids were there for track meet, and they were still writing where the Keegan Morris Parker's truck was parked, etc. So, I do think moving forward, and we'll see how this all pans out, but it's a definite concern. This is still a school district property, and there are people who are concerned about that, and I feel like the city needs to be respectful and considerate of that, at least as we figure how this is going to work out. And I really feel like we could really be consulting. So I'm just bringing that forward on behalf of the Collins Standard, and I would agree with that.
Thank you, Mrs. Collins. Anyone else? Mm-hmm. If there's no other new business, We'll go to board member announcements. Are there any board members who would like to make an announcement? Mr. Lamb.
Today I had the pleasure of watching four of our middle school music ensembles perform at NISMA Majors. I do not know the results for most of them. However, the last group who performed today was our wind ensemble, and they got a level 6 gold distinction. And I have to tell you, as a music teacher, as a parent, as an educator, how proud I am of how well they played. They played the Armenian dances that I played at Allstate, probably better than we played it at Allstate. And Mr. Garner and Mr. Diebelhausen, we congratulate.
Thank you, Mr. Lynn. Any other board member announcements? Mr. Shaughnessy.
Last week I attended presentations at PTAC, chapter presentations before year-end presentation by students who presented 3 minutes on their progress from the beginning of the year to the end of the year. They have some terminology that they use. Groves, meaning things that they want to work on in the fall of the year. Glows, which are things that they've achieved and they're proud of. I was very impressed with the confidence and organization of the presentation, the creativity of their slides, and the level of reflection. It really is something that I wish all high school students had an opportunity to do. These students are very confident in their public presentations. They've had experience presenting to companies throughout the region on projects that they worked on. And I had an exchange with Dr. Corey. One thing that impressed me was that these students are going to graduate. I would think 98%, I mean, if you want to get 100% graduation for these students who are in eighth grade who are somewhat challenged in their attendance and in their enthusiasm for school, PTAC has certainly turned them around. Dr. Corey agrees with that. He did say that after BOCES aid, that PTAC is not as expensive as many districts think it is. And he is very appreciative of Dr. Catalino's support, because without the Kingston population, Kingston population program would be a success. So I left I asked Mr. Turner to put a copy of my email correspondence with Dr. Corey in the library for today.
Thank you, Mr. Shaughnessy. Anyone else? Board member announcements. I would like to announce one thing, and it struck me while all the teams were presenting here. I'd like them to know that the board also did a book study. So you want to talk about race. We read it, we had a retreat on the topic, and are currently reading White Fragility. So we're very much on the same page, and that's a good thing, I think. We can have some very frank conversations next year and ongoing. All right, if there are no other announcements, I would like to actually make a motion that next week, we have to do the board self-evaluation, and if it's into Ms. DePerna by Wednesday, she'll get it duly taped and circulated to us before our meeting following the June 19th. We're going to have a retreat. No action taken, it's just a self-evaluation. So, I would like to propose that Mr. Spicer be allowed to fill out the evaluation form since he's been with us since January. Of course, until he's sworn in again, we can't invite him to an executive session, but I would like to propose that. So I'd like to move that Mr. Spicer be allowed to fill out the self-evaluation and submit it to Mr. Perner. Okay. Any discussion about that? Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you. So, Mr. Spicer, if you're back, we're on for help. All right, and that brings us to the second opportunity for public participation. Is there anyone who wants to address the board at this point? Okay, seeing no takers, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So
all those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, and the meeting is adjourned. We'll see you at the tour, and then again on the 19th. And probably several times in between.